Hong Kong, the Fragrant Harbor. This place is truly special and fascinating in so many different ways. Within 1,100 square kilometers of space, HK manages to squeeze in more than 7 million people, a world record 657 skyscrapers, and a whole bunch of unique history and culture. Culture that, perhaps more than any other place in the world, perfectly blends Eastern tradition with Western influences, creating its own distinctive culture, which is reflected in everything from its language and architecture to the local cuisine. Besides Japan, which you can probably tell by, well, my whole freaking channel revolving almost exclusively around it, Hong Kong has always been the place that has intrigued me the most. Thanks not only to the above-mentioned characteristics, but also because in the 80s and 90s especially, this tiny little place off the southern coast of mainland China pumped out some of the greatest movies that I've ever seen. I mean, who could ever forget Chow Yun-Fat jumping out of an exploding hospital while hugging a baby? Peak cinema. And one of the most unavoidable, but also endlessly fascinating topics found in HK cinema from the 80s, the 90s, and to some extent even the 2000s, is of course organized crime, or to be more precise, the infamous Triads of Hong Kong. In one of my most recent videos, we explored how the Chinese Triads started off as secret societies around 2000 years ago, before experiencing a gradual, very slow shift towards large-scale organized crime with the introduction of groups like the infamous Green Gang. But you won't often hear the term triads linked to mainland China these days. Dramatic political changes taking place in China during the 1950s created a hostile environment for the Chinese gangsters of old, and with that, organized crime as a whole. And so, Hong Kong, then a rapidly growing British colony, became the triads' new playground. Within a few short years, they transformed the Fragrant Harbor, flooding it with violence and illicit wealth, infiltrating the ranks of its police force with their own men, casting a long shadow over everyday life in the colony, and exporting their crimes far beyond the borders of Hong Kong, establishing the Triads as global criminal powerhouses, their name arguably just as feared as that of the Mafia or the Yakuza. So, what exactly made the Hong Kong Triads so infamous? How did they operate, and where are they nowadays? Well, you already know, that is exactly what we aim to find out in today's video. If you like what you see, then don't forget to leave a like, and if you want to see more videos like this one pop up in your feed in the future, also make sure to subscribe, and maybe even check out my Patreon page link below if you want to help me out even more. Now without any further ado, let's take a little trip to Hong Kong, shall we? This is the history of the Hong Kong Triads and crime in the Fragrant Harbor. It's hard to imagine these days, but not even 200 years ago, the area that now houses the place we call Hong Kong and its hundreds of skyscrapers and millions of inhabitants was nothing more than a humble collection of fishing villages. HK's transformation into a hugely important financial center and one of the most densely populated areas on Earth didn't start until the arrival of a major foreign power from the other side of the globe. The British. The British first arrived in Hong Kong in the early 1840s, but the area that now forms HK had at that point long been a refuge for southern Chinese undesirables, pirates, and the likes, which mostly came down to Hong Kong's advantageous geography. Those looking to smuggle or steal found a cozy home here. Located just off the southern coast of the mainland, the area was close to the entrance of what was the only major river system flowing through southern China. A place where trade was to be found in abundance, and with it lots of valuable cargo to steal. While close enough to the mainland to reach it in no time, the Hong Kong area was also far away enough from it to be somewhat isolated from the strict imperial rule that could be found there. Imperial rule that, as you can imagine, had just about zero tolerance for pirate activities of all kinds. The fact that the area was home to a collection of hundreds of different islands made hiding from the authorities a breeze as well. Safe to say, this place was more or less a Chinese pirate's wet dream. In the 19th century, foreign trade, mostly dominated by the British, arrived in southern China, meaning that there was now more precious cargo to rob than ever before. But things got even better, at least for the local pirates. Constant turmoil plagued China at the time, and following the end of the First Opium War between Britain and China and the subsequent signing of the Treaty of Nanjing in 1842, Hong Kong Island, one part of what forms modern-day Hong Kong, was ceded to the British. The southern Kowloon Peninsula and Stonecutter's Island followed in 1860, and the new territories and its many offshore islands were leased from China for 99 years, starting in 1898. If the harbors of Hong Kong represented a cozy home for Chinese pirates and criminals before, they were now a straight-up 5-star ultra-luxury mansion. Because more than ever before, the area was now completely out of reach of the Imperial Chinese authorities. The area's population grew quickly, merchants and coolies attracted by the seemingly endless possibilities in terms of trade offered by the well-situated harbors of Hong Kong. Among those who found themselves attracted to both these job possibilities and the idea of gaining some distance from the mainland authorities was one particular collection of Chinese societies. The Triads. As we saw in my previous video, though things were certainly moving in that direction starting in the 19th century especially, the Chinese Triads weren't inherently criminal. The Triad members that arrived in HK, however, were different. They were either actively escaping the law, or looking to engage in activities that would be much, much more difficult on the mainland. Illicit activities, of course, and the criminal Triads were quick to set up shop in a new British colony. By 1843, only 1 year after the British took over Hong Kong Island, four different Triad societies had already been active in the area. Among them one society which was raided and subsequently arrested by none other than the first ever chief of the HK police force, Captain William Kane, in 1844. A few months prior, in April of 1843, that same Triad society broke into and burgled the house of Sir Henry Pottinger, the first ever governor of Hong Kong. And they reportedly also stole from the three most prominent traders in town, only 2 days later. The British realized that the Triad societies could be a real threat to their grip on Hong Kong. By 1845, they estimated that the Triads had around 70% of the area's fast-growing population under their thumb. But what worried the British authorities the most was the fact that the Triads pretty much ran Hong Kong's entire workforce at the time. That, coupled with their sheer number of members and exceptional organizational skills, meant that by 1845, illegal Triad activity akin to the aforementioned crimes had become increasingly common in the newly established colony. And so, that same year, the earliest version of the Society's Ordinance was introduced. The Society's Ordinance basically criminalized membership in a Triad society, a law that, though undergoing many changes over the years, still stands to this day. The punishment, consisting of a 3-month prison sentence combined with 100 bamboo cane lashes, however, was child's play compared to what happened to criminal Triads on the mainland. And the prisons found in 1840s HK are said to have been pretty comfy as well. All in all, the positives of being a Triad member in Hong Kong greatly outweighed the relatively minor inconveniences and risks that came as a result of such membership. For those who made their way from southern China to Hong Kong, sometimes completely on their own and with no connections whatsoever, the Triad societies provided a crucial sense of community and belonging, a fundamental purpose shared by many of their secret society predecessors from the mainland. As the decades went by, more and more Chinese from the mainland made their way to the colony in search of new opportunities and away from the chaos that constantly made life in their home country a chore. By the mid-1880s, the Triads were the dominant force in the colony in terms of trade. They ran quote-unquote travel agencies for hundreds of thousands of workers trying to make their way to America too, basically robbing them blind by charging insane boarding fees for vessels leaving from ports across Hong Kong and southern China. The stuff that came into the Fragrant Harbor wasn't safe from the Triads either. Be it fish, meat, rice, or vegetables, nothing made it into Hong Kong's numerous market stalls without going through their hands first. And their hands usually demanded a quote-unquote Triad tax be paid. giving them a sizable fortune to work and expand with. They were also feared throughout the colony, and for good reason. Violence, intimidation, human trafficking, and the collection of protection money became the Triad members' full-time jobs. And not even those who were supposed to monitor and punish these sorts of activities were safe. Police informers were straight up murdered, and as early as 1885, the Hong Kong police force reported the existence of at least one Triad member employed at each police station in the area. It was the beginning of a Triad organized infiltration of not only the HK police force, but in some cases even low-ranking government posts. A problem that, as we will see later, wouldn't be properly addressed until close to a century into the future. As Hong Kong progressed throughout the early 1900s, the Triads became increasingly integrated into everyday life in Hong Kong by investing their money into legitimate businesses as cover for their illegal activities, often registering their societies as charities or social and sports clubs. Hong Kong's Triad societies grew bigger and bigger, some more than others, until a good amount of disunity and fragmentation started to plague the big societies, starting in the 1930s. With increased competition, violence and internal rivalries became more and more common. More and more people disappeared. More and more dead bodies appeared. The HK police force, while never allowing Hong Kong-based Triads to achieve quite the same levels of influence as many of their mainland counterparts, were in many respects powerless to stop the infighting and violence at that point. And things were about to get much worse, very soon. Japan's brutal World War II campaign, and with it the conquest of the Asian continent, was in full swing by the late 1930s. The invasion of Hong Kong, an invasion that had been in the works since the 1920s, was up next, and the Triads would profit greatly from it. Or at least those who sided with the Japanese invaders. In general, the Japanese encouraged the activities of the Triads in Hong Kong. They took their share out of the profit made from illegal businesses like gambling and especially narcotics. Opium, to be precise. Opium, despite being smuggled by the Triads in the past, had up until that point actually never been an exclusively criminal commodity in Hong Kong, having been legally available and taxed through official distributors. That all changed with the invasion, when the opium market fell almost completely into the hands of the Triads. The drug was provided by the Japanese themselves, who had long since been using opium as a means of keeping the population of mainland China weak and addicted. A tactic that they sought to continue in Hong Kong as well. It also made both the invaders and the Triads a large sum of money, and so did gambling and prostitution. The latter representing an especially dark chapter of the Japanese World War II campaign due to the existence of the notorious comfort houses, set up for Japanese soldiers in both Hong Kong and China, in many cases with the assistance of local Triad societies. Not all Hong Kong Triads supported the Japanese invasion though. They were basically split between supporting the invaders, supporting the British, supporting the Chinese nationalist Kuomintang, or supporting no one. As if the presence of the Japanese army in Hong Kong wasn't enough, these differing opinions led to even more violence between the Triad societies. At the same time, food scarcity became a real problem, giving birth to black markets which were then also controlled by, you guessed it, the Triads. And in many cases, the only way to survive the invasion and get some actual food on your plate was to become a Triad member yourself. For everyone involved, the Japanese invasion of Hong Kong, which finally came to an end in 1945, was a harrowing experience. Except for the big Triad societies, because after 4 years of doing pretty much whatever they felt like without any sort of police intervention, they were in a better position than they had ever been before. And to further add to their firm grip on the HK underworld, the Japanese had destroyed most existing police records on the Hong Kong Triads, meaning that they were also guaranteed a certain sense of anonymity when the British took back the colony. And speaking of the police, more Triads than ever before found their way into the ranks of the police force when after the war, the police department was incredibly understaffed, which led to countless Triad members successfully applying for a job. The rest of Triad business continued just as it did during the Japanese invasion, just underground. Also, the black market, an important part of everyday life in post-war Hong Kong where everything was still in short supply, was still in the hands of the Triads. In addition, the British military government's hasty prohibition of opium inadvertently transformed it into a lucrative triad monopoly, far exceeding previous profits. Simultaneously, triad societies maintained a stranglehold on the local labor market, a critical factor in the immense reconstruction efforts following the devastating invasion of Hong Kong. Immense was also the influx of refugees coming in from mainland China following World War II. For them, the war was far from over, because the nationalist-communist war flared up once again. Consequently, Hong Kong witnessed an absolutely insane spike in population, growing from 600,000 in 1945 to 2.1 million in 1951. It was thanks in large part to these mainland immigrants, among them landlords, factory owners, and traders, that HK soon turned into an industrial powerhouse. But they also brought something else with them. Competition. Because the established local HK triads that built up a strong power base in their area were now joined by societies from the mainland, where the existence of triads was simply no longer tolerated after the CCP's victory and subsequent takeover of China. Perhaps the most prominent mainland triad immigrant was the infamous Big Ear Du Yisheng, who, operating from Shanghai, controlled pretty much the country's entire opium industry for a few decades, becoming perhaps China's most powerful gangster in history. In communist China, however, opium was out of fashion, and so Du spent the last few years of his life trying his luck in Hong Kong by attempting to keep his infamous Green Gang alive there. But like so many other gangs that tried to gain a foothold in HK after the Civil War ended, the Green Gang faded away in the matter of only a few years. One triad society founded on the mainland that did manage to make an impact in Hong Kong, however, was the infamous 14K, which to this day remains as one of the largest triad societies in all of HK. The founding history of the 14K can be traced to the Kuomintang, or KMT, the Nationalist Party of China under Chiang Kai-shek that had just lost the civil war to Mao Zedong and the CCP. In 1945, KMT Lieutenant General Ko Tsiu-wong was tasked with uniting several triad societies in southern China's Guangdong province under one banner, forming a large triad army that was supposed to aid the nationalists in defeating the Communist Party. The name of this collection of triad societies was to be Sab Se Ui, or 14 Association. Likely a reference to the address of the society's founding location and original headquarters, located at 14 Po Wa Road. In 1949, when the KMT had lost the civil war, its members and supporters were forced to leave the country. A good chunk of them, including KMT leader Chiang Kai-shek, ended up in Taiwan, but some chose to make Hong Kong their new home instead. And among them were the 14K triads and their founder, Ko Tsiu-wong. Where exactly the K in 14K comes from is, by the way, somewhat of a mystery. Some argue that it stands for Kowloon as a reference to Hong Kong's Kowloon Peninsula, others think that it might represent carats of gold and with it good luck. And luck was certainly on their side, because after fleeing to Hong Kong, the 14K really hit its stride. They immediately got to work on conquering the Kowloon area for themselves, including a gang war against the local Yuetung society in Kowloon's Mongkok district. Their numbers ballooned in no time. 2 years after arriving in HK, they counted around 10,000 members. By 1955, 80,000 people, and not just in Hong Kong, but also in other parts of Southeast Asia, called themselves a 14K member. But whenever you hear about these insane triad membership numbers, keep in mind that while being part of a triad society is against the law in HK, meaning that technically every member could be considered a criminal, not every single member of a triad society was actually involved in criminal activities, like violence, murder, drug trafficking, and the likes. Some, or actually most members, joined either out of sheer convenience or to avoid trouble, or they were straight up forced into doing so. Even still, the 14K undoubtedly boasted a massive number of actual active criminals, whose extortion tactics were in some cases so violent that they left even the other triad society's leaders in shock. It was perhaps this shock and fear that also allowed the 14K to capture a large chunk of HK's booming narcotics trade next, which would soon result in an intercontinental and even international drug trafficking network. When Chiang Kai-shek, now the president of the Republic of China in Taiwan, noticed just how much influence the 14K, which was originally his brainchild, held, he saw the society's potential as a way of overtaking all of Hong Kong and once again being able to gain a foothold in mainland China. A classic Chiang Kai-shek pipe dream that never materialized. But nevertheless, he invested a ton of resources into the 14K, which only aided its already massive growth. The 14K was far from the only triad society making an impression in post-war Hong Kong, though. Generally, the 14K is nowadays regarded as one of three triad societies that are the biggest that HK has ever seen, the other two being the Sun Yeon and the Wu Group. The Wu Group might actually be the oldest still existing triad society in Hong Kong, while the founding of the Wu Group's main Wu Xing Wu faction is officially dated as 1930, the roots of the Wu Group as a whole date back all the way to China's Taiping Rebellion of the mid-1800s and the subsequent influx of mainland immigrants into Hong Kong. The Wu Xing Wu played a big role during the Japanese invasion of Hong Kong, spying and reporting anti-Japanese activity throughout HK to the much dreaded Kempeitai military police of the Japanese army. In the 1950s, the Wu Group's different factions, some of them small and with no criminal intentions, started to diversify and focus on different areas of expertise. Things like loan sharking and protection rackets were a big part of the Wu Group's business portfolio, though. But they also had a hand in many other underworld activities like illegal gambling, prostitution, theft, and narcotics. You know, the usual stuff. What really made them so powerful, though, is the fact that they also controlled much of Hong Kong's large pool of dock workers. As you can imagine, a very influential thing to control in a world-famous Fragrant harbor. The Sun Yeon, founded as simply the Yeon in 1919, started life as a society for Hong Kongers of Teochew origin. Ahead of them were four difficult decades, which saw the society appear and disappear, disband and reform on multiple occasions, until finally uniting under the name Sun Yeon in the 1950s, the word Sun meaning new in Cantonese. The Sun Yeon grew at an insane pace and was soon competing with even the Wu Group's Wu Hop To faction over protection rackets in Hong Kong's Wan Chai area. What's particularly interesting about the Triad societies is that, unlike other organized crime groups like the Italian Mafia or the Japanese Yakuza, there seems to have been, at best, a very loose hierarchy within these organizations. And rarely is there ever a single hierarchical structure that applies to every society. A one-size-fits-all hierarchy, if you will. Triads operated more like franchises, where members and factions, despite owing dues to higher-ups, worked independently from one another. There were, however, a number of ranks and positions that formed the basic hierarchical structure of most societies, all with certain numbers associated with them that all start with the number 4. There are many possible explanations for where exactly these rank numbers originated from, but the Triads are so damn old that it's hard to confirm what the real origins of some of their traditions actually are. To give an example, the number 489 was connected to the rank of Dragonhead, alternatively called Mountain Lord. I prefer Dragonhead because it sounds sick, so let's go with that. The Dragonhead didn't just have the coolest sounding title in the whole organization, he was also its highest ranking member. The Dragonhead served as the ultimate authority within the organization. Responsible for resolving internal disputes and charting the society's overall course, he also maintained a largely hands-off approach to daily operations. His directives, however, were absolute and unquestionable. Just below the Dragonhead, you had three different positions, all carrying the number 438 and all of equal importance. Assistant Mountain Lord, Incense Master, and Vanguard. The Assistant Mountain Lord acted as the Dragonhead's right-hand person, providing counsel on critical matters and assuming leadership responsibilities in the Dragonhead's absence. The Incense Master was responsible for initiation rituals, which the Vanguard assisted him with. But the Vanguard also functioned as a sort of operations officer, and it is now believed that oftentimes, the Vanguard actually had the most acting power within a Triad organization. Another three positions follow below that. The White Paper Fan, or 415, basically the bookkeeper and legal expert. The Straw Sandal, or 432, who acts as a messenger and organizes Triad meetings, And of course, the famous Red Pole, or 426, the enforcer, who takes care of the unpleasant stuff. With up to 50 men under his command, he takes care of everything that requires intimidation or an unhealthy dose of violence. Or both. The lowest tier of the traditional triad hierarchy, and the one that actually makes up a good majority of their membership, consists of the 49s or 49ers. No relation to the San Francisco 49ers. Or is that just what they want us to believe? The 49ers could be considered triad foot soldiers, and the only ones even less important than them, in terms of rank at least, are the so-called Blue Lanterns, uninitiated members who don't even get assigned one of those fancy numbers. That's the basic model that triad organizations are thought to have been built around. But as mentioned before, these hierarchical structures could vary greatly from organization to organization. The Dragonhead, for example, was usually an elected position. But as we will see later on in this video, the Sun Yeon, for example, maintained a hereditary leadership structure, at least for a while. And none of this stuff seems to be all that relevant anymore these days, though. Over the last couple of decades, most of these ranks have slipped further and further into obscurity, with triads now often consisting exclusively of 49s and Red Poles, with multiple Red Poles forming a sort of council where a chairman is then elected. Kinda sad to see an amazing title like Dragonhead just disappear like that. What also faded away, or at least changed significantly over the past couple of decades, were the famous triad initiation rituals. There are, again, many different versions of how these rituals actually went down. It's safe to assume that, much like the hierarchical structures that we just looked at, every triad society chose to do things at least a bit differently. But again, there were some key elements that seem to have found their way into pretty much every initiation ritual in the past. These rituals generally took place inside a temporary space called a triad lodge, which could be anything from a basement to an alleyway. The triad initiation ritual comprised a series of symbolic actions, all rooted in the traditions of their ancestral Chinese secret societies. These included the passing through various gates and performing certain rituals, culminating with the initiate washing his face and body, symbolically washing his old life away, ready to be reborn as a triad member. He then sips from a bowl containing a mixture of wine, animal blood, and burnt ashes from a yellow paper. To illustrate what happens to traitors, the bowl is then broken into pieces, and last but not least, the initiate swears the famous 36 oaths, which demand from the new member complete loyalty and secrecy. This whole process used to take up to 6 freaking hours in the past. But due to increased pressure from law enforcement, these elaborate rituals have been replaced by much simpler procedures that can be performed in about 15 minutes, where the initiate simply swears the 36 oaths in front of an altar dedicated to Guan Yu, the god of war. The gradual intensification of police pressure on the triad throughout the latter half of the 20th century can be traced back to one single, pivotal event on October 10th, 1956. October 10th, or Double 10 Day, is an important date for Chinese nationalists, marking the day of the first act of the 1911 revolution under Sun Yat-sen that led to the establishment of the Republic of China. It was a day of celebration for hundreds of thousands of Hong Kong citizens. But on the Double 10th of 1956, an argument between nationalist and communist supporters escalated into full-on riots that lasted for 3 whole days, taking the lives of 59 people, injuring hundreds more, and causing damages upwards of $20 million. The communists blamed the nationalists. The nationalists blamed the communists. But the police blamed the triads. And they weren't exactly wrong either. The 14K, which, as you may remember, had received funds from none other than Chiang Kai-shek, were found to be heavily involved with much of the violence and chaos that occurred around October 10th of 1956. They set up roadblocks and charged tolls. Citizens were threatened with violence if they didn't buy Kuomintang flags for ridiculous prices. Banks were stormed, factories burned, and communist sympathizers and foreigners were beaten, or even worse, killed by 14K members. It was a dark chapter in Hong Kong's eventful history. But the 14K and all their triad rivals and brethren would pay dearly for their actions. More than 10,000 Triad members were arrested over the 18 months following the riots, with the help of not only a newly established specialist task force, the Triad Society Bureau, but also with the help of many old-school Triad members who did not support the Triad-induced violence that took place on October 10th. It was also around this time that the HK police truly started to understand the Triad Society's structure, traditions, ceremonies, and criminal activities for the first time. The Triads were now firmly on the radar of Hong Kong's law enforcement, forced to dial down the violence significantly for the time being. But the few thousand Triad arrests that occurred as a result of the riots of 1956 were but a small dent in their membership numbers. Their old friend, the narcotics business, was as profitable as it's ever been, especially as Hong Kong was entering a period of massive economic growth. And of course, they still had their people sitting not only in every police station across Hong Kong, but also in pretty much all branches of its government. A blind eye was turned to this problem for years, simply because neither the police nor the government saw any reason to fix it. The Triads had become somewhat of an acceptable evil in their eyes, now focusing mostly on crime that was able to stay underground and away from the general public. Like extortion and gambling, and even a narcotics business didn't lead to many problems, at least in terms of violence or theft, with HK's addicts usually being able to hold on to full-time jobs. In fact, Hong Kong boasted the lowest murder rate on Earth at the time. But of course, the parasite that is corruption cannot be ignored forever, and it wasn't until a huge scandal in the 1970s that someone finally took the corruption problem by the scruff of the neck, transforming corrupt Hong Kong into one of the least corrupt places on Earth. In April of 1973, it was discovered during a routine bank check that Peter Fitzroy Godber, a very high-ranking police officer in Hong Kong, had been transferring an absolute fortune onto a Canadian bank account, around $200,000 in March of that year alone. When Godber received a letter by Hong Kong's acting attorney general asking him to account for his wealth, he packed his bags and escaped to England. Found in his Hong Kong apartment were a number of incriminating documents that revealed that Godber was a multi-millionaire. Something that doesn't quite add up, considering that he was a police officer. Well, turns out the guy had been accepting bribes from the Triads for years. How much he received in total, or for how long exactly, is unknown. But when he was finally deported from Britain back to Hong Kong in 1975, he was sentenced to 4 years in jail. In light of the Godber scandal, the government of Hong Kong finally woke up and took action. They established the Independent Commission Against Corruption, or ICAC, a special commission completely independent from the police department with the right to raid homes of individuals and their relatives and demand proof of finance for every purchase that the ICAC was suspicious about. Basically, if you spent a bunch of cash and the ICAC thought that something seemed off, they had you by the balls. And what they discovered was truly eye-opening. Triad-related bribery reached the top brass of the Hong Kong police force. Most notably, Lui Lok, a sergeant of the HKPF with several police medals to his name. Turns out that Lui Lok, referred to by junior officers as Tai Lo, or Big Boss, was also a senior member of the freakin 14K, making bank of gambling and narcotics. And when I say this guy made bank, I mean it. The media started referring to him as the $600 million man. Lui Lok never faced any punishment though. Him and four other corrupt sergeants, collectively known as the Five Dragons, man that sounds cool, left for Vancouver before finally escaping to Taiwan, a place with no extradition treaty with HK and, at the time, the number one destination for all deported Hong Kong Triad members. Back in HK, the ICAC was making moves, overseeing a complete cleanup of the HKPF that successfully ousted most of its Triad collaborators. They definitely dealt a big blow to the Triads. But on the other hand, it was just as much of a punch in the gut for the HKPF itself, which was now severely weakened and understaffed. The Triads used the HKPF's mass exodus as an opportunity to expand and gain a head start, most notably with the help of a new kind of narcotics business. The heroin trade. When you speak about Triad-related drug trafficking in 1970s Hong Kong, you are speaking about three underworld figures in particular. Ma Sik-yu, aka White Powder Ma, his younger brother Ma Sik-chun, aka Golden Ma, and Ng-sik-ho, also known as Limpy-ho. A name that I'm sure the comedians in the comments will have an absolute field day with. The Ma brothers got their start on the streets of Hong Kong, going from working as runners for local gamblers to running their own numbers game, making enough cash to allow them to enter the narcotics business themselves in the late 60s. White Powder Ma especially was super ambitious. He wanted to control everything from heroin production to distribution, and to do so he entered into a partnership with a Kuomintang general called Li Wen, who was hiding in Southeast Asia's Golden Triangle. Li Wen would supply Ma with the stuff and smuggle it to HK for him. In return, and for a tempting discount, Ma entered into an alliance with the Kuomintang, setting up a network of Triad Society spies that kept a close eye on pro-communist organizations throughout Southeast Asia. As a result of this deal, the Ma brothers' heroin empire would grow and grow, eventually involving many other parts of Asia as well. Thailand, Vietnam, Laos, and White Powder Ma allegedly met with some of America's most powerful mob bosses as well, among them Santo Traficante Jr., and also reached out to the Yakuza in Japan regarding a potential partnership. The Yakuza, it is said, were not interested in collaborating with the Ma brothers. While White Powder Ma was out and about setting up deals and meeting one shady individual after another, his brother Golden Ma would stay in Hong Kong where he received the product and laundered and reinvested the profits made from its sale. Trading companies, cinemas, restaurants, bars. But he also founded the Oriental Press Group, the publisher of what is still one of Hong Kong's most successful newspapers, the Oriental Daily News. The Ma brothers also made sure that HK's biggest Triad societies all got a piece of the pie as well. The Wu Group assisted the import, the 14K was involved in the refinement process, and the Sun Yeon was responsible for the many bribes that were necessary to keep things running smoothly. Heroin became not only an insanely dangerous habit the world over, but also an extremely profitable one, and the Ma brothers had a massive stake in it all. It wasn't until 1976 that they finally caught the attention of the HKPF, who dedicated an impressive 60 police officers just to catching the Ma brothers specifically, all with the assistance of the DEA, Interpol, and the CIA. Golden Ma was caught, but weirdly enough got released on bail, while his brother was able to escape to Taiwan before ever getting caught. Both Ma brothers ultimately spent the rest of their lives in Taiwan, where they were able to continue running their business and drug empire far away from those who were trying to put them behind bars. As massive as their drug empire was, the Ma brothers never had an actual monopoly on the heroin trade. Not even in Hong Kong, actually. Ng-sik-ho, aka Limpy-ho, was the Ma brothers' biggest rival. Born as the son of poor peasants in a village in China's Guangdong province, Ho had a tough road ahead of him. He joined a local Triad society as a 49, and at age 21 moved to Hong Kong with no money in his pocket, no acquaintances in HK to speak of, and not even able to speak the local Cantonese dialect. What saved him was a Hong Kong Triad society with roots in his hometown, where he worked his way up the ranks, making it past the rank of Red Pole in no time, and eventually gaining so much respect among Hong Kong's biggest triads that he eventually became an honorary member of both the 14K and the Wu Group. This guy was obviously not to be effed with. Ho entered the narcotics business in 1958, selling heroin from one of his fruit and vegetable stalls, which soon earned him a respectable 2,000 Hong Kong dollars per day. Ho was successful, too successful in the eyes of some of his rivals, and after making the beginner mistake of selling inside another Triad Society's territory, he was ambushed and attacked. His right leg was beaten and completely shattered with a pole. From that moment on, Ho was forced to walk with a limp for the rest of his life. Limpy Ho was born. He might have been down a leg, but that didn't stop the guy from continuing and even growing his narcotics business. He purchased a small tea shop where sales were agreed upon with customers, and a rice shop where the product was sold hidden inside barrels of rice. A clever plan thought to have been the brainchild of Ho's closest partner in crime, Ching Yeting, who was also Ho's wife and the ex-wife of one of Ho's former Triad associates. According to Triad Oath number 34, this should have gotten Ho killed by, and I quote, a myriad of swords. but for now, he got away unscathed. Both Ho and his wife would serve multiple short jail sentences throughout the early 1960s, but business kept going without a hitch, and Limpy Ho was ambitious. He wanted to be more than just a small-time street dealer. Just like the Ma brothers, he wanted to control the manufacturing process and the supply as well. And the chaos created by the 1967 anti-British riots in Hong Kong would create the perfect environment for him to start doing so. He used his own ships to transport the base from Thailand to Hong Kong, where it would then be refined in his own laboratories tucked away in the busy streets of Kowloon and the hills of Hong Kong's New Territories area. By 1970, Ho made an estimated $22 million per year, which he wisely reinvested in both legal and illegal businesses. For Ho, Hong Kong wasn't enough though. The international market was calling his name, but after a failed attempt at rivaling the Ma brothers' heroin export to the US, he had to look elsewhere. Europe was to be his domain, and by 1973, he was the biggest heroin dealer on the continent. Limpy Ho's imminent downfall was caused by several different factors. For one, he was starting to lose the trust and respect of the Triads, who had learned their lesson that keeping things low-key was important for survival. In their eyes, Ho was starting to live a bit too lavishly. But it was also his failed attempt at conquering the US market that landed him on the DEA's radar. And when Hong Kong's newly established ICAC started rounding up corrupt cops in the mid-1970s, their eyes automatically shifted to Ho's activities as well. And they had a couple of very significant informers on their side too. The Ma brothers, who readily, and I suspect with a shit-eating grin on their faces, supplied the ICAC with information about their biggest rival. It worked. By 1974, Ngshik Ho was done for. He was arrested and the following year was sentenced to 30 years in Hong Kong's max security Stanley Prison. Limpy Ho's arrest was a watershed moment in Hong Kong's criminal underworld. Never before had local law enforcement managed to lock up a crime boss of his caliber. He did manage to be released on bail in 1990, but only due to his failing health. He succumbed to liver cancer in 1991 at the age of 61. Ho's arrest also marked a turning point for the HKPF and the ICAC. Boosted by their success and newfound expertise, they entered the 1980s, a decade that would witness a few explosive clashes between law enforcement and the Triads. Perhaps the HKPF's most noteworthy coup involved an insanely elaborate, 8-year-long operation carried out with the help of a certain strategy that has since become a staple in Hong Kong cinema. A good old undercover operation. All the way back in 1979, the HKPF tasked two of its inspectors with infiltrating the ranks of none other than the 14K, placing them as street vendors in Kowloon's Mong Kok area, right at the heart of the 14K's territory. They were eventually enrolled in one of the 14K's factions as 49s, and over the following 7 years, they would gather invaluable information to supply the HKPF with. This was an insanely risky operation, one that requires some serious balls. Because, as you can imagine, and as we've learned from that poor broken bowl during the initiation ritual, the Triads do not take kindly to traitors, especially of the law enforcement kind. The two HKPF agents, though, did a great job at blending in with the rest of the Triad members, allowing their partners at the HKPF to get an in-depth understanding of the 14K's inner workings. In a coordinated strike in 1986, the police targeted the 14K's lucrative horse racing betting operations. Simultaneous raids on 43 bookmaking centers resulted in a massive roundup of Triad members, which also yielded crucial intelligence, leading to the arrest of several high-ranking 14K figures. It was a huge victory for law enforcement, because while dealing a huge blow to the Triad's morale, the HKPF also slowly but surely proved itself to be one of the finest police forces in all of Asia. One that was able of meticulous planning and pulling off insanely high-risk operations, like this one. And they didn't stop there either, because their next target was to be the top brass of the Sun Yeon leadership. For 2 years, starting in 1985, the HKPF had been studying the inner workings of the Sun Yeon, a society which was, as they found out, incredibly well organized and united, especially compared to some of its biggest competitors, where competition between different factions was not only common, but oftentimes even encouraged. They also discovered not only that the Sun Yeon's dragon head had been in charge for around 3 whole decades, they were also able to identify him. The dragon head of the Sun Yeon was Heng Wai-im, a senior clerk at the Samuel Su and Company firm of solicitors, and the eldest son of Heng Qin, the man who revived the Yeon after World War II. But perhaps even more interesting than his father is one of Wai-im's 12 siblings, his brother Charles Heng. You may have never heard of the guy, but there's a good chance that you're familiar with some of his work. This guy was a big deal in the Hong Kong film business. Charles founded both Wins Entertainment and China Star Entertainment, two of Hong Kong's biggest film companies at the time that helped kickstart the careers of some of the former colony's most legendary actors. Jet Li, Chow Yun-Fat, Andy Lau, Stephen Chow. Basically, if there was a Hong Kong movie star in the 80s and 90s, there was a good chance that they worked with Charles Heng and his production companies at some point. Well, all except one. The biggest of them all. Jackie Chan, now a controversial man in his own right, not only managed to get his career off the ground without the help of the Heng family, he was also known to be incredibly outspoken when it came to the Triads and their grip on Hong Kong's thriving film industry.
I'm the first one to say in the newspaper, I hate the bloody gangster.
This man hates the Triads with a passion, and in 2012, he went as far as claiming that he once defended himself against a band of Triad members with the help of, and I quote, 2 guns and 6 grenades. This particular comment actually got Jackie into hot water with the Hong Kong authorities because of the area's incredibly strict gun laws. But let's be honest, while I don't doubt for a second that the Triads were a real pain in Jackie's ass, and I commend him for speaking out and defending himself, he was talking out of his ass here. Or at least, he was greatly exaggerating the amount of heat he was carrying. Going back to Heng Wai-im, the dragon head of the Sun Yeon, he was the main target of a set of simultaneous raids on the Sun Yeon and its members that took place in April of 1987. Equipped with a search warrant, the police stormed his office, located in a skyscraper in Hong Kong's Central District. What they found was a Sun Yeon membership list, confirmed by a police informer to be legit, and a metal seal, engraved with the name Heng, the character On, surrounding it 5 times. A Triad expert later confirmed that this was indeed the seal of a dragon head. Heng Wai-im was eventually sentenced to 7 years in prison in 1988, but won an appeal and was released from prison 2 years into serving his sentence. But despite that, another big blow to the Triad's confidence had been dealt. Crackdowns continued as Hong Kong entered into the 1990s, but while the HKPF certainly did a great job at making the headlines with big arrests, the Triads were just too deep-rooted into Hong Kong society to ever be completely eradicated. Instead, they evolved, and the evolution of Hong Kong's Triads in the 1990s kind of mirrors the trajectory of their Yakuza counterparts over in Japan at around the same time. Similar to Japan's Crime Countermeasures Act of 1992, Hong Kong's Organized and Serious Crimes Ordinance, or OSCO, of 1994 granted law enforcement expanded authority in the fight against organized crime. Of course, one of the most defining moments in Hong Kong's history came only 3 years after the introduction of OSCO. At midnight of July 1st, 1997, 155 years after the Treaty of Nanjing was signed, and 99 years after the new territories were ceded to the British, all of Hong Kong was transferred back to China. It's honestly pretty hard to find reliable information about what exactly happened to the Triads after the handover of Hong Kong. For example, actual membership numbers, which had always been kind of misleading due to the Triads' nature of not being exclusively criminal, are hard to come by. Triad-related crimes in HK seem to have gone down significantly. But those numbers go hand in hand with a decreased number of overall crimes taking place in the former British colony. Again, much like what seems to have happened with the Yakuza in the 1990s especially, a move away from violent crimes and a shift towards legitimate businesses, yet with a touch of shadiness, of course, seems to have taken place. The market for illicit goods that Hong Kong was once the center of, interestingly, seems to have moved to the mainland, with southern China and its fast-growing economy offering a new, exciting market for local triads and those from Hong Kong who seek to collaborate with them. Of course, that doesn't mean that Hong Kong is completely free of triad violence now. Articles like this one from 2020, reporting about a shooting that was the result of a dispute between two factions of the war group, still pop up here and there, confirming that while the triad's presence is a lot more low-key than it was in the 70s or 80s, and while an increasing amount of their illegal operations seem to have moved to the mainland now, the triads undoubtedly still hold a significant presence in Hong Kong. Was there anything I got wrong or missed out on? Did Jackie Chan actually fight the triads with guns and grenades and I unfairly accused him of being a liar? Whatever you got to share or get off your mind, let us know in the comments down below. Are you one of my loyal Patreon supporters? Then this is the part where I want to give all of you a massive shout out, including Bobby Wu, Javier Soravia, Capybara Chuck, Turom, Daniel Dees, RK0, White Gildan, Justin Down, Yoko the Space Whale, Steve Matsui, Cats in Soup, and Chard B-Man. And to everyone who decided to watch this one all the way until the end, thank you so much for watching. Apologies to all Cantonese-speaking viewers for completely butchering this. Choi Gin.